Hello. Hi. Good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for coming to Chapaka today for this wonderful talk that we're going to have. So welcome, Arishiti, welcome, Amber, and welcome, Vidushi. And I'll hand over the mic. But just before I do that, like a school teacher, I'm going to request people to come and fill in the front seats so that people who come at the back will have space and the middle chair if possible. Anyone? Just like the students.
We're not doing it for the members.
Thank you. Thank you. And we'll be doing the
Hi everyone. So my name is Arindajit. I work with the Center for Internet Society with Kutumba, and I'll be moderating and facilitating this discussion. It's a great honor to be moderating a discussion featuring two researchers who've really sort of been very generous with their time. Whenever I ask them to meet me to discuss my research, they've been very nice to me, and I'm sure they will share a lot of insights today as well on their specific research. So Amber is, as I said, works at CIS with me, and he does a lot of research on digital ID, on privacy, on AI, and of course he has done a fair bit of work which you can see in front of you on social media. And Vidushi works at Article 19, which is an international organization. She's also an academic, and she works on AI primarily, but she's also written a lot of cool stuff about social media and their regulation. And she's appeared on a lot of very interesting TV debates. So I think I'm very looking forward for her to share her insights here. So thanks again for coming, and we'll just start right away. So as you know, we're here to discuss a fantastic book by Amber called The Networked Public. I think the name was perhaps inspired by Walter Lippmann's 1922 book called The Phantom Public in some way. But this is a book about democracy, even in the absence of social media. This is a book about politics, both in India and abroad. And this is a book about taking concepts that have been, I would say, unfortunately entrenched within policymaking or legal circles, and trying to bring them out to the public and the Indian public in a way that is accessible for all. And I think that this is the first step of facilitating participative discourse on one of the burning crucial issues of our time. So the first question, I guess, that I had for Amber was, before we move on to the specific question of social media, let's talk a little bit about, before we move on to the question of democracy, rather, let's talk a little bit about social media itself. So in your book, the second chapter is titled The New Gatekeepers, where you sort of look at social media companies and their practices. And you talk about concepts like echo chambers, where basically people who have certain political leanings, these leanings get entrenched because of the way social media platforms are wired. So, but this is something that people who have been dealing with traditional media have also said in the past. So Noam Chomsky, who wrote the book called Manufactured Consent as far back as 1988, referred to three things, which were how like communication media function as effective political and ideological institutions because of market forces, internalized assumptions, and self-censorship, which are all three concepts that you've discussed in the book itself. So how is social media different from previous forms of entrenchment, and specifically how is it different from traditional media, and how you covered this in the book?
Thanks a lot, thank you for the introduction to the book, and that's a very nice way to begin that discussion. Am I audible to everyone, or should I speak louder? I think as Arindajit mentioned, the title of the book itself, I had to essentially struggle a lot with my publisher, because the title that I wanted to begin with was The Phantom Public. And at that point, I think eventually my publisher convinced me that people would not, it would make the book slightly more, less accessible, and we sort of settled on The Networked Public. But essentially the ideas in the book goes back to discussions that happened in an American book called The Phantom Public 100 years back. And the book sort of begins with that idea that a lot of discussions, a lot of concepts, a lot of problems that are discussed in a book published in 1925 continue to remain relevant. In fact, if one picks up that book today, you may as well sort of feel that it's a book written about today's times. And in that sense, even though we're talking specifically about social media, which is a phenomenon that we've only dealt with over the past decade, a lot of problems that we face on social media are not unique. These are problems that have existed for a long time. So problems such as misinformation, problems of extreme speech, problems of the manner in which people engage with information about them, that has been around for a very long time. And in fact, I think the book that you referred to, Chomsky's book on manufacturing consent, the term manufacturing consent also goes back to the phantom public. So the involvement, I think the interesting thing to understand here is in what ways social media either exacerbates that problem or perhaps changes the nature of the problem in some sense. And I think there the sort of virality or the ubiquity of social media and the kind of unfettered unfettered dissemination of information that happens to it is what makes it fairly unique. And it's not that things didn't go viral before, right? So in the mid-90s we had this whole rumor about about every single statue of Ganesha in the country was drinking milk. Or I think some of you might have read a very popular short story by Ruskin Bond called The Boy Who Broke the Bank, where he talks about where there is essentially a young boy who's a sweeper in the bank and he hasn't been paid, and essentially that leads to rumors that the bank must be going bankrupt. And sort of it's really comical, but it's also a very interesting parable on how information spreads. And what I think makes the sort of introduction of social media very unique is the manner in which we engage with it now, is the fact that information is not tailored specifically for us. The kind of personalized targeting that you have is completely new. It's not that targeting did not happen before. Right? There were always surveys done. There were always understanding that people from this age to this age could prefer a certain kind of packaging of information. But now there is targeting at the level of a specific individual, which makes it unique. And there are other authors who've written about that in some detail. There's a book that I refer to by Eli Pariser called The Filter Bubble. And there's been a significant amount of debate for the last few years on how effective that bubble might be. Do we really get impacted? Do we get stuck in echo chambers and we start believing in things as a result of that? And there is, at this point, still very little sort of empirical data to say anything one way or the other. But what remains very clear is that the manner in which we consume information now and the manner in which algorithms and social media are structured, which are meant to prioritize a certain kind of content over others, that definitely plays a huge role in how we consume that information. That even if that doesn't play a role in convincing us of the role that, let's say, extreme speech or fake news might be intended to be in terms of convincing people to in favor of particular ideology or persuasion, what it definitely does to, without doubt, is make people stay stuck within their ideologies to a certain extent.
So, throughout this discussion, I'll try and leave some quotes from the book and read them out to help structure discussion as well. So the quote I'd like to put to Vidushi as well is from the book is, "The answer to the public's problems must be found in how it exists socially and deliberates as a group." And I think this is a powerful quote, and I want to bring this to Vidushi because in a paper that I think she wrote a couple of years back, a quote from that paper is that fake news is a social problem exacerbated by technology. So Amber, of course, refers to social media companies as the new gatekeepers. But in a paper that you refer to, in that paper, they are also referred to as the new governments. So how do you, I mean, view social media companies in the landscape that we exist today? How is society specifically vulnerable today to the sort of impact that the new governors or the new gatekeepers, however you see them, actually might have?
Yes,
yeah, so
I think when we saw a lot of these conversations around fake news and misinformation coming up, especially after Trump became president, it was like the technology is terrible and we need to fix the technology and Facebook is the devil, which may well be true. But I think at that point wasn't constructive because it ignores the social complexity in which Trump became president, right? Basic basic aspects of humans have not changed. Like, we like to believe really bad things about people we don't like. We like seeing things that are very extreme. We like reading things that confirm biases that we already have. And this has always been the problem. What technology has done has made the speed of that insane and the reach of that insane when you compare it to, say, the 1800s. And also, I think an important difference with social media is that, you know, back in the day, we could all access the same piece of news and all engage with that particular piece of news. So consuming information and forming political opinions was a social thing. But now we form political opinions in bed, on Facebook, on Twitter, in a way that only reconfirms what we already want to believe. And what that ends up doing is that leaves less space for nuance. So a lot of people are saying, oh my god, the world is really like unforgiving and there's no nuance anymore. It's kind of true, because we are more set in our ways when it comes to thinking about certain things politically. The quote about fake news being exacerbated by technology, I think, also was trying to make the point that like, let's take, for example, WhatsApp lynchings, which Ambal covers excellently in his book. So when there were all of these lynchings because there were WhatsApp forwards being sent about people, you know, this woman is trying to nab these children and then people were killed, and it was really, really horrifying to see. A lot of people said, let's shut down WhatsApp. It's encrypted. Let's break encryption and make sure that everyone can read what the issue was. But actually, it's like the technology was one part of it. The actual issue was that our systems of public governance, our law enforcement's way of interacting with people from certain sections of society was poor to begin with. So when you had a problematic piece of information, it's the surrounding social context that failed us, not technology. And I think that is really, really important to constantly keep in mind, even with the spyware and WhatsApp. Like, if you've been following the news recently, everyone's been saying, oh my god, WhatsApp is terrible again. Because there was spyware that was sent to human rights activists and lawyers, you know, and WhatsApp's encryption is not perfect. But actually, the real question there was, well, why was the government installing spyware in the first place, right? And that is, again, a social context, and that's a social question. So I hope that answers it.
Yeah, thanks. So again, Vidushi, I think, gave an excellent interview to a TV channel. I forget which channel, but you should check that out. So now let's talk a little bit about the core facet, or supposedly the core facet of any democracy, the people. So in the second or the third chapter of your book, I think, is called The Irrational Public. And there you discuss cognition and psychology and how psychometric analysis was used, specifically with reference to the Cambridge Analytica case, across contexts. But is there something special or something unique about how people behave and how people think that may, again, make such cases like Cambridge Analytica and the psychometric targeting that Alexander Kogan, who's getting the name wrong till half an hour back, actually successfully did, or successfully did for the worse?
So I'll begin my answer by referring to Alexander Kogan, who actually Arindrajit has met once. Right? So it's one of the most notorious people in the world that you can name at this point. When we think about how we consume information, a lot of research has been done, a lot of papers have been written in the last few years about like what is this problem about? And a lot of focus on that research is often either on the technological architecture of, let's say, social media platforms that play a part in the dissemination of that information, or there is focus on specifically where that information might be coming from, what is the nature of that information. But there is very little work done specifically on the role that people themselves play and how they engage with that information. And there's a controversial report done by BBC last year specifically on WhatsApp in India, and they call this the people-sized hole in this sort of area of research, that nobody is actually paying attention to how we consume that information and what is the role that we play in sort of both spreading it in terms of forwarding things to each other, in terms of how do we react to information that is presented to us. And that's where it's important to understand that a lot of times, even when we think of solutions to these problems, so the most popular sort of response to this problem of fake news is to do fact check. The fact that there is information out there which is false,
how do we respond to that? We tell people that this is false. And I think, at least in popular culture, the most sort of dominant example of that was in the presidential debates in the US, when Hillary essentially went on fact-checking things that Trump said. But what is, I think, important to appreciate is, much like the way we consume information is complicated, even the way we need to correct our beliefs about that information is also extremely complex. So there is a school of communication theory, which is notoriously called the magic bullet or the hypodermic needle theory, where essentially people think about information as some kind of a syringe that gets that you can basically insert in your body. And then the moment you have that information, you are activated in some sense, and you can do things based on that information, you can apply it in some sense. So, and the sort of tragic part is that several generations of communication theorists have debunked this particular point of view. But it's like every decade, every time we talk about this, we're back to the hypodermic needle theory, and a new generation of communication theorists have to now go about debunking it. So it's not that when we are faced with facts, or when we are faced, for that matter, with fake news, we are immediately activated by it. We immediately start reacting to it. Our reactions are much more complicated. They come, much like Manush was saying, they come from a social context. They come from our existing belief systems. And if we have to understand why people react to things in a particular way, then we have to go back to that. And essentially, propaganda campaigns or misinformation campaigns are most effective when they recognize sort of certain propensities that people have, certain belief systems that exist within communities, and then leverage that to sort of activate a particular group of people. And similarly, responses to that problem also must do the same thing. If we have to respond to the problem of fake news, if we have to respond to the problem of extreme speech or hate speech, then we must recognize where that is coming from. What is it in people's social context? What is it in their backgrounds? What is it in their belief system that makes them believe it? And that, I think, is one sort of part of the book that tries to address that. Both looking at communication theory and then also looking at the sort of theories around how we consume information. And I think the interesting thing here is that even though the chapter itself is called The Irrational Public, Lippmann back in the 20s said that the most sort of significant aspect of people at large is that they are irrational. And what I have tried to at least argue is that it's not the irrationality that is most important, it is the fact that we are, as individuals, we are as society, hyper-social. So we essentially believe in our meanings come from things that are around us. We believe in things based on what we have heard, on what, in the ways that we have been conditioned. So even when we receive a piece of information, there is a sort of, even though there is a subconscious level, there is a subconscious way in which we consume it. So we ask ourselves whether it agrees with our sort of worldview and belief system. If it doesn't, then we immediately question it. We ask whether the piece of information that we have received makes sort of composite, is it cohesive in some way? Does it make sense to us? Does it contradict other pieces of information that we've heard? So when we react to a specific piece of information, we're not merely reacting to that one piece, but essentially our reactions are based on a set of beliefs that we might already have. So that's something that we don't talk about when we talk about sort of responses to fake news, when we talk about solutions to misinformation. And that is a conversation that needs to happen much more urgently.
So before I come to Vibhushi again, just a quick follow-up on, is the context different in India at all? So is targeting more or less likely in a heterogeneous context like India, which is slightly different from the studies that have largely been sort of Western-centric? So you touch upon this a little bit in your book, so maybe just for a slightly Indian perspective on this.
So when, for instance, the Cambridge Analytica scandal happened, that was essentially about the use of a platform like Facebook in order to target people, in order to both at one level collect data about people and then use that data to target them with information, right? Now, the sort of the interesting thing is perhaps as much as horrifying as Cambridge Analytica was, and it truly was horrifying, perhaps what Cambridge Analytica's best step was that publicity. The fact that they were able to convince so many people that they could effectively run sort of propaganda campaigns. And there is actually nothing that suggests that anything that they did was really successful. Because essentially all of these are based on some kind of personality tests, some kind of analysis of behavior of human beings. So what do I like on Facebook? What do I read? What do I, in what ways have I reacted to certain pieces of information? So there are various kinds of data points that, let's say, a company like Cambridge Analytica can collect. And then the focus for them is they rely on sort of fairly dubious kind of theories on how we behave and what does it tell about our political proclivities, for instance. So if I'm risk averse, does that, is there a greater chance that I'm an American of my being a Democrat? And things like that. And particularly when you try to bring that idea of those kinds of personality tests, because essentially all the psychometric profiling that is being done on this platform is based on essentially standards that have been developed in like maybe a couple of countries in the world. And when you try to impose that especially to a multi-ethnic and multi-party country like India, I don't really see how one would even go about using it effectively. So that's another part. Though I think in India the context is a little different. The platform that gets used much more is WhatsApp. And there have been some truly sort of ingenious ways in which WhatsApp has been used to spread misinformation. And perhaps that's something that we'll come back to later.
So yeah, and just on my relationship with Alexander Coben, I met him in December 2017, well before the scandal broke out, and our conversation was about pork chops or something. So I'm not his lackey or something like that. So let's go back to Virushi. Let's talk a little bit about tech. Virushi, as I said, works extensively on AI and use cases of AI, regulation of AI across a set of domains and a set of spaces. So my question to you is sort of, I guess, twofold or threefold. What role do algorithms play here? And how much do social media companies know about me through their data-driven practices? And the third is, what is it about their business model that makes them specifically pernicious or not? So if you can sort of cover all three in one answer. As I'm sure you, as I know you already have in papers, I'll be
clear.
So I
just want to pick up on something Ambar said about Cambridge Analytica, right? Like the entire premise was, they're going to get you to sign up to a personality test. They'll ask you a bunch of questions and then manipulate you. When the Cambridge Analytica scandal, as we call it, broke out, my first reaction, and I'm sure this was the reaction of many people who work on this for a living, was, so what? Like, this is literally proof that Facebook's business model is what we think it is. It's literally proof that it works. And what Cambridge Analytica did, and this might get me into trouble, but what Cambridge Analytica did was kind of what Obama did in 2008. He used a social media platform to manipulate people into acting a certain way, and because it happens to be palatable to most of us, it didn't cause the kind of uproar that Cambridge Analytica did. Having said that, I think it's also important, and I'll answer the business model question, I think, is really interesting, because if we look back on Facebook's algorithm, right, what is the business model? The business model isn't let's get a billion people interested in their lives or make them happy. As much as Facebook likes to say it, I'm sorry, I'm not buying it. Their business model is to ensure that you spend the maximum amount of time on their platform as you possibly can. So their algorithm that underlies your newsfeed, that underlies which friends you're suggested, you know, that really creepy suggested friends button that like somehow you met someone at a party and Facebook knows, all of that is not optimized for your benefit. It's optimized for your time and your attention. And I think when we talk about regulating Facebook and trying to think of ways in which to make fake news and social media better for democracy, it's kind of like we're sitting around a terrible table that is doing all sorts of horrible things to us and serving us junk food when we should be eating greens, and we're sort of like rearranging chairs around that table. Right? The problem is the table. The problem is the algorithm that underlies your newsfeed, because it doesn't care about what is good for you. It cares about what will keep you on there the longest. So I think that is really something that we need to, like, a lot of people have started saying let's burn it to the ground, which is a bit violent, but I don't know. Maybe they're onto something, because the point is that you can, so for instance, when we look at algorithms, a big problem around tech circles is, oh, this is just too complicated, there's no way we can explain to a human, there are a million data points, no human is going to understand. The issue there is that we're acting like a transparent algorithm would be okay. If Cambridge Analytica was completely transparent and told us exactly what they were doing, they would still be problematic because the outcome and the intention was problematic. And I think reckoning with that is hopefully something we'll see in the next decade. Hopefully we'll break Facebook into six different things, or, you know. And also I think thinking about it like we think about an advertisement company and not thinking about it like a social media company. I don't even know what that is, because their business model, again, is your time and attention so that they can sell you ads. What was your second question?
No, just on like how vulnerable am I to Facebook? Like, how much does Facebook actually know about me? How much does it actually influence the decisions that I make on a day-to-day basis? I am on Facebook.
As am I. Someone needs to be there to, like, you know, give them greetings. So, if you think about the way AI works, like, I've been told by people who use machine learning for credit scoring to decide whether or not you should get a loan, that six data points are enough to know XYZ things about you. Or, you know, you can get your location, your phone number, your email, and what you ate for lunch yesterday, and they can make XYZ assumptions about you. Facebook claims to know who you're going to date before you know who you're going to date. They're really good at the suggestive friends thing, for sure. So I think, like, thinking about how accurate Facebook is, maybe it requires us to change the question a bit, because when we think about it, we're giving them data all the time, and there's never a clear use case for why they're collecting that data. They make sense of the data as they go about. So sometimes I've seen ads that I would never click on, and that's clearly like a faulty output of their algorithm, but they have enough data about us for us to be constantly scared regardless of, you know, one or two red-herring cases.
So when you brought up Obama, I was just thinking, when his campaign happened in 2008, it was celebrated as a success of, you know, just targeted campaigning and reaching out to people at as granular level as possible. And my father, who is a diehard Bengali, said that Left Front has been doing it for 30 years. So, like, what is special about this Obama film? He's done well. So Obama, and I think it's a perfect segue to the question of democracy, because Obama's campaign was heralded as a victory for democracy, and a book that Amber, that I've read, and a great book that Amber refers to, is Levitsky and Ziblatt's work, that basically suggests that democracy is a function of institutions and norms. And if constitutions start eroding away or moving away from norms, then that would be a shift towards autocracy. So what Amber does in his book, which I think is extremely impressive, is that he actually, before discussing social media companies and their impact at length, he looks at the present state of public institutions in India and abroad. And I think when we look at the threat to democracy across the world, it's not, I mean, technology is a major threat. But, and I think I'm going to quote another quotable quote from his book, is that the forces of technology have restructured human relations time and again in each instance, and in each instance, the public's way of accessing meaningful information. So a major part of the story is actually about democracy in public institutions itself. And then you put social media companies into the mix. So I think Amber has covered this across a few chapters. So I'd just like you to talk about the state of democracy in India and abroad, and sort of what the key threats are, and possibly how social media companies play into these key threats.
I think the primary thing that I was trying to focus on was, how do we understand democratic processes around us? And then what are the ways in which that is changing in the world right now? Now, the most obvious way to look at whether a particular country is a function of democracy or not is whether the people turn up to vote, which is how we sort of measure these things. We have measured these things for a long time based on that. But merely having people vote doesn't make a functioning, thriving, thriving democracy. What makes a democracy work is are there sort of deliberative institutions that exist, which allow people to come together and debate issues. So for instance, in India, if you look at the first 15 years of sort of, you look at the data from the parliament,
from Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha in the first 15 years and compared to the last 15 years, there is a stark difference in the amount of time that has been spent essentially debating legislations. And we have elected representatives, and they're supposed to represent our sort of interests in particular ways. But we are not, what we are essentially are a republic, right? We're not a democracy in the sense that you and I don't get to sort of vote on whether this particular policy is going to be passed. It is people who we voted to power who do that. So in order to hold people to account, there needs to be some institutions where even beyond electing people to offices, do people have sort of means and ways at their disposal to think about how to hold them to account. So for instance, deliberations that happen in the parliament is an important one. Do people have means and ways at their disposal to organize protests when they don't agree with a particular sort of law, for instance? So these are very important questions. And over a period of time, what has happened is that there are independent institutions, public institutions that have developed, which hold, for instance, the elected representatives to account. In India, those institutions would be, for instance, the Supreme Court, for instance, the Comptroller and Auditor General, which is in charge of like auditing financial records of governments. There are also like softer institutions, institutions that the three of us are part of, which is civil society, often the sort of least powerful of these institutions. So, what in order for democracy to truly sort of survive and function well, all of these institutions need to hold each other to account properly, and that is the trend that we see not globally changing over the last sort of few years. What you have is very, very popular mandates in several countries, so essentially, we don't think that democracy may be in danger as a result of that. So there is a scholar that I quote in my book called Nancy Verner, and she uses the term democratic backsliding. So she says that maybe 40 years back, the thing that you had to be scared of was that there would be a coup in a particular country, and essentially the sort of the president of that country would wrest power, or the military would sort of impose military rule in it. Or essentially, then we also lived in a bipolar world, so they were backed by the Soviets and the Americans. So that has changed significantly over the last few years. Also with the amount of information that is available, it's very hard to pull off a coup. I mean, you need secrecy, you need sort of several people to come together, you need the right people to not know about it. This is much harder in the world that we live in now. So the sort of bigger threat to democracy is not from somebody sort of overthrowing the government, but it's from the government itself accumulating more and more power gradually. That's a more insidious way of sort of threatening democracy. And that's what we see now across several jurisdictions. In some cases, when you have a fractured mandate like Trump had, or in some cases you have a very sort of overwhelming mandate, and then there is gradual erosion of power that other institutions have. And social media plays an interesting part in it because the way discourse about sort of power changes is very interesting. So, one of the things that I try to do in my book is to look at, for instance, Supreme Court decisions in the last few years and the kind of very stark cognitive dissonance we had within the court. There could be on the same day, the court might say one thing in a particular case and entirely another in another one. And often it's not even that different judges, often there are even the same judges who sit on those benches. So it's very interesting because, and also like when you have discussions in the parliament, both in terms of the language that gets used, in terms of how people refer to facts, when you have discussions sort of on news channels, that's not something that I need to even say anything about. So there, I think the impact of social media is very clear because discourse making has changed so drastically over the last, let's say, 5 years. And that clearly is something that we see playing a very, very clear impact on our institutions.
So there is a sort of a law called Godwin's Laws on social media, which says that any discussion inevitably leads up to a mention of Hitler, and I'm guilty of that here. But I think it's I think important to remember that one of the biggest threats to democracy, which was possibly the election of Adolf Hitler, was not through a coup, not because he went with the German army into that power, but because of the fissures that existed in normative processes during the Weimar Republic. So that's why I was. It was great for me to read the in-depth analysis that Ambar did of social institutions and public institutions today. So another book that there's been a series of books sort of on democracy and the future of democracy and whether democracy is ending. One of these books is called How Democracy Ends by David Runciman. He actually argues that democracy is not sort of on life support, but it's undergoing a midlife crisis. And I'm not sure how accurate he is, but there are certain things, midlife crises could be fatal, but if you do the right things, then potentially it could, that's what he says, it could save the person, and in this case, democracy. So Vidushi has had at least in my conversations with her, she's interacted a fair bit with public authorities and at least done a fair bit of research on them, specifically in the context of AI, but I think she's gained enough experience to sort of tell us a little bit about what she thinks about the future of democracy and whether it's on life support or whether it's at a midlife crisis. So, a non-tech question for Vidushi.
I want to see how far you could take that metaphor, but I have a tech answer though. But I think in my experience of doing field work and engaging with authorities that take problematic steps like have a facial recognition system, watch our every move and decide who's a criminal and not, I see two things, right? So on one hand, it's like we believe that tech will solve problems. So we believe that tech is this amazing cure, it's a silver bullet to very complex social problems. Emerging technology is always accurate. If you use a lot of data, you can't be wrong. If the computer said it, it must be right. And on the other hand, it's like we brush off any accountability because the machine did it. So WhatsApp is responsible for Pegasus spyware because it's WhatsApp, not because the government did what the government did. So we kind of use technology as this shield against holding democratic institutions accountable in the way that we grew up understanding, or at least we were taught in constitutional class or civics or whatever you may have studied. I think the externalizing that tech affords democratic processes is a big problem, and I feel like it can be a midlife crisis that doesn't end very well, unless we start having more tech, more lawyers who understand technology and more technologists who understand the social implications of their work. Because the minute you have an engineer saying, what I do is not political, I'm just building a system that will sort five people out based on XYZ characteristics, understanding that that is a political choice, and for lawyers and legal scholars and civil society to be able to engage through a legal lens and say, well, actually that is problematic for XYZ reasons and your technology in its design and development is flawed, is something that we really need urgently, and it's something that three of us work on, so I should not be looking for perhaps, I don't know, what everyone in the audience does, but we'll stop there.
I'll just make a sort of one point on that. So in 1992, I think Francis Fukuyama wrote this book called The End of History. And there he essentially spoke about how liberal democratic constitutional governments are now the norm. And over the last sort of 500 years, we've worked towards that norm, and now that is what it is. So if you look at history as essentially a sort of a story of how the ways of governance of people changes over a period of time, then these are now, we've reached the end of it. And it's 17 years only since he said that, and no longer are liberal democratic governments the norm anymore. So I don't know whether, in terms of whether it's a midlife crisis or whether it's
it is truly on life support. It's hard to say. It could be both, actually. You could have, be having a midlife crisis and be on life support.
Yeah.
So I don't think it has to be one or the other. But these are cyclical things, right? You go through 30 to 40 year cycles of how the world changes around us. And one hopes that's what it is. But the I think to go back to what Vinushi was saying in terms of the fact that we sort of blame technology, it's also very interesting because what technology has done over the last, let's say, 10 years is that there is a lot of technological circumvention. So I am not, for instance, Uber, I am not a cab company, I am a technology company. And it's only coincidental that what people do use Uber for is for cabs. Or I'm not a logistics company, but I'm a technology company. I'm not a delivery company, but I'm a technology company. So tech companies essentially have used these sort of strategies to circumvent regulation for a large period of time. And it's sort of poetic in some ways that now you have governments actually circumventing their own responsibilities by shifting the blame to big tech companies.
Francis Fukuyama, when he wrote the book, he thought he was going to become a rock star, and he said it was the end of ism, so to speak, the end of terrorism, the end of populism, all those things. And since 1992, I think he spent every book trying to say that no, this was not wrong, and that this is actually what I meant. So every single book I've read of Fukuyama's since then is trying to clarify what he actually meant in 1992. So it's an example of how sometimes academia just gets it plain wrong. And I think the best thing for him to do is to say that he was plain wrong. So the next section of this discussion will probably make everyone think of a line from a movie called A Few Good Men. And the line is, let's kill all the lawyers. And this is on the regulation of social media platforms and what the solutions are to this problem. I think Amber's done a great job in his book of actually discussing some fairly legalistic solutions in I think, fairly accessible language. But so Walter Lippmann, in his 1925 book, said that the solution is actually lies in epistocracy, where a set of elite entities or individuals decide the future of decision-making processes. And of course, there was a debate that he referred to with Dewey, where he says that's not the best solution. So just in terms of these two forms of solutions and where social media companies fit in. So are they supposed to do the regulating where Facebook decides to curate and moderate free speech? Should governments have more of a role? And it's interesting, and just before I frame the question, again from David Runciman's book, he makes a very interesting comparison between Facebook and the present French government, where he argues that they are structurally very similar because they sort of put forward these values of openness and freedom and consultation, but actually they're a very sort of centralized top-down process where in the case of the French government, it's Macron making all the decisions. In the case of Facebook, it's Sheryl Sandberg and Mark Zuckerberg. So when we think of solutions, how do, sort of let's leave civil society out, but governments and private sector actors, I mean, but what is the way forward?
Just a small correction there, I think. A Few Good Men also came out in 1992, the same year as Fukuyama's book. But before Aaron Sorkin said that let's kill all the lawyers, that's actually a line that goes back to Henry VI by Shakespeare.
Oh, yeah.
So they've been trying to kill lawyers not for a very long time. We haven't quite succeeded. But I think the sort of broader question that you pose about where do we go from here? I mean, I think sort of we touched on that a while back. Sort of should we start breaking up tech companies, because essentially they are not one company. They are companies that play, at the same time they're media companies, at the same time they're publishing companies, at the same time they run social media platforms, and essentially in each of these roles they're also advertising companies. So I think one of the ways forward that people have spoken about is that is the problem primarily that these are there is concentration of power across these entities. And can we then turn them into several smaller entities? And will that address the problem? I don't know. That is definitely one way to think about it. And I think there is some sort of slightly more legal discussion in the book that happens about competition law itself and how, over a period of time, we've tried, it has changed. And let's say pre-1981, Facebook could not have existed in this form.
is how the American law around competition and antitrust changed after that, which enabled it to turn into what it is today. If we had the same law that we had in the 1970s, that governed competition law, then this is not a problem that perhaps we wouldn't have had. But like we said earlier, it's not a problem that is limited to tech. It's a larger social problem that we're talking about, right? And the bigger problem that we're getting at is how do people come together to discuss problems, and how can, and based on those deliberations and discussions, how can the choices that we make over a period of time be more informed? And that is essentially the exercise of the democratic experiment. So, I think a country like India supposedly has had a long history of deliberation. We've had institutions going back several centuries that have enabled a very sort of bottom-up kind of deliberation. You know, those institutions are not robust anymore, at least here. But I think the answer has to be in what John Dewey said, is that it is not the irrationality of the public that is its most defining feature. It is a sort of idea of sociability, that they rely on each other to form opinions, they rely on each other to make decisions, and that's essentially like evolutionary biology supports that idea, that the one thing that human beings want to do more than anything else is free will of one another, and that's sort of over several generations we've seen that happening. So I think we have to find a way for the consumption of information and how we then act on the basis of it to change. There are several sort of multi-headed problems. I think fixing the tech is one part of it, but then also holding our institutions to account would be really important.
Same question. How do we solve this?
Can you hear me? I think self-regulation is an absolute no-no, because in 2018, Mark Zuckerberg was called before the US Senate, and he was asked, you know, how are you going to solve this problem of fake news? And he said, we're going to use AI, which for me was the first red flag. And then the second thing that they asked him was, you know, how are you going to, like, account for freedom of expression? What is your freedom of expression standard? And he said, well, speech that makes anyone uncomfortable is speech we're not going to allow. Which, as a legal standard, makes absolutely like no sense to me. And that, for me, was the point at which I was like, any kind of self-regulation is probably going to be very, very problematic. I think I also see a trend within industry that's really strange, where, you know, for years they've been saying, we're not an X company, you can't regulate us. And now Microsoft has come out and said, please regulate facial recognition. And a lot of these huge companies, like Facebook, is asking for regulation. And I think the problem there is, again, in our democratic institutions. Because often, when regulation is framed in countries, it's Facebook sitting on the table to frame it. And that sort of co-opting of the policy process, of the regulatory process, makes me really, really nervous. So self-regulation, I think, is an absolute no-no. But I also think that one of the options, and this might not be very sound regulatory theory, so my apologies in advance, but I think a lot of the tech that we're trying, and a lot of democratic processes that we're trying to regulate now, sort of start with the assumption that this is allowed. So it's like, you can have, I'm just holding on to facial recognition now, like you can have facial recognition, but don't do X, Y, Z. And we're sort of treating technology as inevitable. We're sort of treating problematic institutions as inevitable, and let's make this horrible, inevitable situation better through regulation. But actually, the role of regulation is to correct for market failure. And Facebook has demonstrated market failure again and again and again. And we can't keep starting from the point of let's be in damage control. Sometimes regulation needs to set the pace. And I think that sort of shift in our processes, in procedure, in outcome, in outlook, whether it's at the Supreme Court or whether it's at a policy process that's looking at intermediary liability, I feel like that needs to change before anything else.
So let's not kill all the lawyers, let's kill big tech. Yes. So this is the rare example of a discussion which is actually exactly fitted into the time slots we have planned. So there's plenty of time for questions and comments from the audience. So I guess if you just raise your hand. Should I get the mic?
Yeah.
Okay.
Am I on?
Yeah.
Okay. Alright, so let's say, let's assume that no one outside of India is going to regulate Facebook for the purpose of this question. And let's focus on India. So we have a religious nationalist government, and we also have a Supreme Court.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, and we also have a Supreme Court that's taken, or rather had some problematic judgments. Very simple. So the question is now, given that our government sort of has a proclivity for using, or rather abusing power, as Indians, what do we push for? Do we push for regulation, therefore putting more power in their hands? Or is there a way for us to hold them accountable, or to sort of have institutions hold social media companies accountable without handing over that power to the executive to be moving on? Or how would you imagine we would go about this? What do we push for this?
So without, what you need is checks and balances there. So I think, for instance, if you, the sort of primary cause of worry for executives to have, for the executive, for instance, to have a major amount of control over the reputation of, let's say, a social media company like Facebook, would be that they would get access to a lot of sensitive data about their own people, right? So I do think that there needs to be very, very clear checks and balances in place. And obviously, like in this country, we still don't have a data protection law that governs in any way how personal data of individuals that is collected by both the state and the private sector gets regulated. So I think first step is to have those checks and balances in place. And then perhaps the other question could be that is it the executive that needs to regulate them? Do we need to have a separate regulator for certain things? So for data protection, for instance, the discussion so far has been that you have a separate regulator and an independent regulator. So much like you have SEBI or you have RBI, who are supposed to be independent institutions. To what extent they are remains an open question at this point. But they are designed to be independent institutions. So I think at one level we need to look at the design of these institutions themselves to see what we can do to make them more independent. But I do think that in some cases perhaps the executive might be in a much better position to actually regulate this. Especially when you're regulating powerful actors, but then it is much more dangerous if that is happening without sort of those checks and balances in place.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think just in terms of how do we deal with problematic institutions, this is something I think about a lot, and this is not a perfect answer at all. But I think that there needs to be a clearer way of people who want to hold those systems to account to also articulate the problem. Because I think a lot of I feel like our messaging around accountability somehow gets lost. And I don't know if it's because of the algorithms, or it's because, you know, there's just more money on the other side, or if we just don't have any power. But I think also thinking about ways in which we can show evidence of harm and evidence of you got that wrong, or evidence of you can do so much better, in a way that the other side, and whatever the other side is, whether it's a Supreme Court or, you know, I think just keep on keeping on. And that's not a rigorous answer at all, but I also think that the problem is sometimes that we're just not effective. Yeah.
So more questions. And we can sort of start at QI.
So my question is, isn't the question really, when you say regarding Facebook, right? So isn't the question really, the corporations don't really care about the greater good, rather than, I mean, you know, we are saying Facebook doesn't really care about how that information is being used. But in general, I think corporations don't really care about the greater good, and that is why you need regulation, because if you have an FMCG company, say, which produces talcum powder, and you know what happens with Johnson & Johnson and stuff like that. If you don't have regulation in place, they are going to use the easiest way, the cheapest way to get the product out to you. And so do you think that there's any, social media companies as opposed to the broader corporate world, how is it different? And what do you have to say about some of the positive aspects of social media, like maybe the Arab Spring? I had read somewhere that there was a positive effect, right, where they were essentially rebelling against tyranny, and social media helped in that.
just pass the mic and we'll take both the questions.
Thank you. So halfway through the discussion, there was a focus on techno-solutionism, right? How if there's a social issue or there could potentially be a market for something, then an app can be built, and then that can potentially solve or get us closer to a solution. And then very quickly, a follow-up was on technological circumvention as well. And I find that to be a very interesting paradox of, on one side, it's a solution, but on the other side, it can be used as a way to redirect focus and attention. And I think the quote was how governments, let's say democratic ones, are shifting responsibilities that they should be, you know, these institutions, these norms that they and we should be upholding, but also they're shifting their responsibility to tech companies. There's something that I'm trying to understand this a bit more. Can you elaborate on this solutionism that comes with technology, but also this circumvention?
So you can take both the questions.
So on the question about, you know, companies just don't care, are social media companies different? I think you're absolutely right. The problem is the business model and the fact that the business model incentivizes this particular type of company, which is a social media company, to sell out attention and to optimize for what will make us more shocked and engaged, as opposed to, you know, actually looking at what freedom of speech means and how speech should be taken. I don't think social media companies are different from different companies. I think it's just about the bottom line, and Facebook's bottom line happens to sit on an advertising revenue, and so they do all of these things to fit with their bottom line. Which is why, like, going back to the table example, if we can shift chairs around the table, it doesn't help if the table itself is problematic. So I think you're absolutely right. On the tech solutionism bit, I'm trying to think of an example. I think 2 years ago, or maybe 1 year ago, I can't exactly remember, the Indian government wanted to do sentiment analysis on Facebook. So what they said was, they're going to use artificial intelligence to figure out problematic people and problematic posts, and if the companies don't take them down, we're going to hold the companies liable. And we want all problematic, and I'm saying that in quotes because that's not a legal standard at all, and I think there's something like notorious post or something that had no legal basis or no legal sort of standard that was clear to everyone. They wanted an AI system to take these posts down. So what happens there? So the first assumption there is the tech will get it right. The tech is efficient enough to go through millions and billions of posts and get it right. So that is the bit where we move to technological solutions without accounting for social context, without accounting for the fact that there are different, you know, ways of speaking English, that are different ways of speaking any other dialect that, you know, we have, how many languages? 3,000. I don't even know. We have a ridiculous amount of languages in India, and I can bet any amount of money that an artificial intelligence system cannot be equally accurate given where technology is currently. It won't be accurate at, you know, detecting speech from different languages. So the first is, it will solve our problem. It will accurately solve our problem. Let's assume that the system gets it wrong, that it starts censoring only a certain type of community. Then the government can go back and say, well, it was the system, it wasn't us, we didn't get it wrong. And at the same time, the government incentivizes Facebook to take down more content than keep it up. Because if they leave problematic content up, the government will hold Facebook liable. But if they take down more than they're supposed to, the government is still happy. So that's why solutionism is, you fix the problem. If you don't fix the problem, it's not our fault. And the outcome of what you do is problematic in a legal way that we could never do without the technology. But let's use a really complicated system to sort of obfuscate our responsibility.
So Ambar, just the second aspect of the first question. Can social media companies actually potentially in any way be a force for good? So you were discussing coups earlier on, and one of the, in recent history, one of the best examples of a failed coup was the case of Turkey, where Erdogan, the prime minister, was partying somewhere outside and then found out that there was this coup happening by the military. And then because of protests that happened against the coup, which were again because of social media, the coup was possibly prevented. Now, whether Erdogan is a dictator or not is a separate question. He's not being very nice to the Kurds right now. But the question is, can they potentially be used as a force for good, particularly in reference to their safeguarding of democratic processes, and also, like we saw in the Arab Spring, potentially holding, sort of speaking truth to power?
And also, just to add another point with regard to your question, and I think there is at least one part of both the questions which is related. This is about technological circumvention. So the issue is also that if you have a private company which is essentially performing a public function, so the board, the BCCI for instance, is a private entity, but it performs a public function, which is the governance of one of the sports in the country, right? So they're expected to be subject to certain public responsibilities in that sense. It gets far more complicated with social media, for instance. So now, for instance, the Twitter handle of the Prime Minister of this country is extremely popular. There are several announcements that are made on the Twitter handle. There are several ways in which the Prime Minister, for instance, reaches out to different people through that Twitter communication. If I'm blocked, for instance, by that Twitter handle, then I'm denied access to public information, essentially, right? So, in one way, these platforms are also used as official modes of communication because they are so effective, and why shouldn't they be used? And then the other problem is also that when they become the primary sort of place for certain kinds of discussions. So even, for instance, traditional media companies, so newspapers, TV channels, they've also been essentially private companies, and they're driven by a profit motive, and why shouldn't they? That is essentially their responsibility to their shareholders, right? But when they perform functions which have such an important role on the public, then we regulate it in very specific ways. So I think that is the problem, that now more and more social media does play roles which are of the nature of public functions, but we still don't know how to think about regulating them. And because of everything, because it has happened so quickly, and every other year they're actually, in terms of the kind of roles that they start playing, it changes, it increases, it evolves. So we have to be able to think about it in an organized fashion at all.
So they can't be a force for good?
No. I mean, they can be a force for good. I mean, the Arab Springs and everything, people speak about specific events where social media was important in terms of it provided a platform for people to rally together, and that was to a large extent the sort of the more romantic story about social media. When a lot of these platforms were launched, they sort of positioned themselves as such. In fact, when Facebook launched itself, it positioned itself as the most privacy preserving social media platform, because it was at that point better than MySpace and Orkut or whatever existed at that point, right? So they position themselves as sort of platforms for social good, and perhaps in limited ways they have performed that function. There is a lot of sort of writing which talks about how even when they have performed that function, it has been very, very superficial. And in fact, if you look at any of the social media driven movements, the thing that you want to then understand is how sustainable those movements have been. And there I think they have a very big slip on it. So it's not that they can be, something they can't be a sort of vehicle for social good. They definitely can be and have been in the past. But more and more, I think as they become more mainstream, they have become spaces where we need to start thinking about regulating them much more.
So before taking more questions, I'm going to ask the organizers how much of time we have left. So about just one question. Okay, so last question. First hand is. One more after.
Okay,
so
I wrote this question down so I don't forget it. So you spoke about the magic bullet theory, and as you said, a lot of theorists have debunked it. They call it unidirectional, like how there is only the bullet goes only in one direction and there is only consumption happening. So do you think, I was wondering if you could talk about how, if something similar is happening through social media right now, like a unidirectional flow of information, and how it affects us, or the general masses, or something like that. I'm trying to understand more.
Okay. Maybe one last question, sorry, one question.
So I'm wondering, what is the role of users or end consumers and their agency? Because at this time, we're struggling between actually trusting the government and actually trusting the tech companies, and my life trust doesn't really lie anywhere. So how can we make some of these tech solutions, or even, for example, privacy statements or terms of agreement, which all of us just think, okay, and most of us probably struggle with, either we don't care about privacy or we struggle between FOMO and privacy and we go with FOMO. So, so in such a landscape, how do we actually enable greater use of agency?
And one last point, if you can make it quick.
At some point you mentioned competition law, and that's something that's coming. It's fascinating to me how you would envision a framework in the context of technology companies. Because there are two schools of thought essentially, right? That either you can go with the benefits of the consumer and that, or you have regulations and mechanisms that ensure a free and fair market. And often these can be at odds, and now substitutively there's a concept is sort of even more complicated to the same. I mean, this is not in terms of social media in specific, but talking technology companies. The same thing you buy in a shop, in a Kirana shop nearby, you can buy at Amazon, and probably Amazon. And so that sort of competition law framework, how do you sort of envision that moving forward if you're talking about technology companies? And I mean, maybe then you can extrapolate the social media within different ones in itself, but just on a broader sense, if you could elaborate more on the competition law.
The magic bullet theory, I don't talk about it, so I'm going to let Ambar like address that fully. About the users, I think in 2015, Facebook wanted to launch zero-rated free basics. And there was a campaign that a million people took part in, and actually Facebook did end up launching it here, which I think was, for me, the gold standard in how end users can make their voice heard. But of course, that was like a black swan moment. You know, we didn't envision a million people signing up and things like that. But the answer I give you is very closely related to your question, which is that there is no viable option, which is why it's so impossible to not click, okay, please take all my data, right? And I think when we think about market failure, when we think about abuse of dominant position in competition law, there are ways in which we can argue that what Facebook is doing now is abusing dominant position. Whether it's like, you know, you're too opaque, you don't have standards of accountability that make any sense. Even when something like Cambridge Analytica happened, Facebook just sent them an email saying, can you please delete your data? And then they didn't follow up, right? Like, that would not fly if it was a competitive environment, because they would be worried about, you know, people can switch between places. But I think the network effects of these platforms are so big that there's definitely a competition law argument to be made. And I think Lina Khan has made it very, very well. And I think just building on that work and contextualizing it for India is really
important. I think with regard to the magic bullet theory or the hyper-permittal theory, I think that the sort of broader point that I was trying to make is that both in terms of how communication is, how, for instance, something like misinformation is received by people, and how we also want to address that problem by introducing, say, something like fact-checking. Like, both, I think if we think that because people have received information, they believe in it, and if we believe that now that we have corrected that information or they won't believe in it, both suffer from the same sort of lack of understanding of how we consume information, and they're both premised on the idea of magic bullet theory. Once information has been provided to you, now why haven't you changed your mind? Like, what is wrong with you? So, except people are far more complex. I think that was the broader point. I think the specific question that you asked, whether consumption of information on social media is unidirectional, I'm not entirely sure what that means. Perhaps we could discuss that offline after this. And I think in terms of your question about competition law, I think the one thing that is interesting is because the way competition has changed in the last, let's say, 40 years was based on the idea that, well, as long as prices don't increase, any kind of practice is fine, right? So if the primary purpose of regulation is to protect people, and what is the way in which people can be harmed is that if prices go high as a result of dominant positions.
if prices don't increase, then what's the problem? And that entire sort of framework fails completely when you are talking about a market where people don't compete on the basis of price at all. You're talking about a series of free services. And it is, like Manushu said, the other factors of network effects that play a much greater role. So I don't have a framework on how that would work. But we had a framework before 1981, for instance, in the US. We had a different kind of understanding of how we want to regulate behavior of certain parties. We could perhaps go back to that framework and see how to apply it.
1981, I'm guessing, was the year legal got elected, and therefore neoliberalism started, and we are where we are. So thanks everyone for coming. Just a huge shout out to the organizers and the team at Champaka. I believe the cafe is shut, but the bookstore is still open, so please do buy books. I've already been scanning some books that I might like to buy. Thanks everyone. Again, thanks for coming on. Thanks to Ambar for writing the book and participating in the discussion. Thanks to Manushi for lending some guidance to itself. So.
Thank you. So I'd like to thank the two people sitting beside me first for agreeing to be part of this discussion and sort of holding this so effectively. Thanks to everyone who's here. Thanks a lot to Radhika and everybody at Team Champaka for making this possible. Thank you to Pranav. Thank you to Pooja for sort of making sure that this sort of event happened properly. Thanks to everybody who turned up. I hope this was useful in some way.
You're giving signed copies and stuff.
I thought you were going to say that.
So he is giving signed copies. The books are
by his book.
Yes, by his book.
It's great, I've read it.